All the speakers, we are live now. All of us are live on the Facebook page.
Okay.
We'll just begin in some time. Another 3 minutes to go. One important thing before we begin for all the speakers, I request everybody to keep their mics muted. Only when I call out your names, you can unmute your mics. Please mute your mics till then. Yeah, thank you so much. We're just going to begin now. I welcome the viewers of this webinar today. May peace, mercy, and blessings of Almighty God be upon all of you. A very good evening and a warm welcome to all the wonderful people attending this webinar. I am Halima Sadia, passionate about making a difference to my life as well as others' lives. I've done my BSc in psychology, Diploma in Counseling Skills from Banjara Academy, Diploma in Montessori from Indian Montessori Training Center, Karate Black Belt, and a teacher by profession. I'm a member of WORK and will be the host for today's webinar. WORK stands for World Organization of Religions and Knowledge. This webinar will be followed by a question and answer session. Audience can pose their questions in the Facebook comment section. Feminism isn't about making women stronger. Women are already strong. It's about changing the way the world perceives that strength. Women have the power to create, nurture, and transform lives. Some of her strengths include patience, empathy, nurturing, organizing, teamwork, multitasking, and the greatest strength women possess is the ability to love unconditionally. Every woman's success should be an inspiration to another. We are strongest when we cheer each other on. Today, we have with us women who are specialized in their fields who will enrich and inspire us with their knowledge and experiences. Before we move on, I would like to list our speakers for today. Our first speaker for today is Mrs. Teresa Rodrigues, a school counselor. She will address us on mental well-being of parents and children. Our second speaker for today is Dr. Girja Sanjay, a gynecologist who will speak on women health issues. Our third speaker is Ms. Rajeshwari Nag, a life skill trainer. She will throw light on fighting depression. And our last speaker is Ms. Nazia Kausar. She's an active member of WERC, and she will help us connect with the topic, how faith affects women. To our audience out here, I request you all to feel free to write comment in the form of appreciation, feedback, or question. Do mention the name of the speaker along with your question. I am sure all of us will have a lot to take from this inspiring evening. Family is the nucleus of a society. Stronger families will lead to stronger societies. Parents play an important role in a child's life, especially in promoting good mental health. Let's listen to our speaker who will talk about the mental well-being of parents and children. Let me introduce our speaker to you. Mrs. Teresa Rodrigues is a teacher by profession. She has been a teacher for Cluny Convent High School, Malleshwaram, Bangalore. She has rich experience of about 45 years in education and has expertise in subjects like English, history, and economics. Her interests are dramatics and counseling for parents and students. Mrs. Teresa is passionate about teaching value education to children at all levels and have conducted 10 webinars in the last few months for Madhupan Publishers, webinars for teachers on online teaching, mental and emotional well-being of teachers, teaching English language and literature in ICSE schools for Karnataka ICSE Schools Association, importance of English linguistic skills in the corporate world for postgraduate students of St. Agnes College, Mangalore. I invite you, ma'am, to enlighten us on the topic, mental well-being of parents and children. Over to you, Mrs. Teresa.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my, can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, yes.
Okay, good evening, everyone. And thank you for giving me this opportunity to share my views on the topic, mental well-being of parents and children. Now, when mental well-being is essential for our overall well-being, and is as important as our physical well-being, I should say. Only when we are mentally well can we actually work better and enjoy our leisure. Stress is one of the most important problems that we hear about these days. Everyone whom you meet says, I'm under stress. There's so much stress in life, etc., etc. But stress is experienced by everyone. So we do not have to get really worried about why am I stressed as such, because none of us is free from it. Yet, very high level of stress can have an adverse effect on our health, leading to problems like headaches, back pains, shoulder pains, upset stomach, etc. So what are the various causes of stress? Stress could be because of various reasons, but to mention a few, it could be because of prolonged illness, maybe because of financial instability, uncertainty about the future, unemployment, strained relationship, and the list goes on. While some of us are able to manage the stress and carry on with our life, there are a few who get hooked to the negative and difficult thoughts and get pulled away from their values of the desire to be what they want to be. So consequently, we tend to easily give up or recall and think about the past bitter experience and love to live in that, blaming the circumstances and the people who are responsible for that. And as a result, we may easily get into arguments. Sometimes we may withdraw and stay away from people, which is not a healthy sign as such, I should say. Now, what is emotional well-being? Emotional well-being is the overall satisfaction we get about ourselves and our life when we have the feeling that I'm able to cope up with the daily stress, I'm able to manage my negative emotions, or I'm having supportive relationship with my spouse, or I'm being able to do and enjoy things that give me happiness. Let me tell you, none of us is perfect and all of us face challenges of life. If your anxiety, your depression, your stress goes out of control, I suggest that you better look for professional support. But because of the day-to-day stresses, I would request you to go through a few questions that I will be putting up on the slideshow at the end of my speech. And if you get positive answers for those questions, you can feel very good about yourself and give a pat on your back. Now, in looking after yourself, let me tell you, you are not being selfish, because it is important to take care of yourself as your entire family depends on you. You are very important for your family, so you need to take care of your health. As parents, we all want to do our best and give our best to our children. But if we ourselves are not fit, we ourselves have negative attitude about life, do you think it will be easy for us to give that emotional support to our
Ma'am, not able to hear you.
Yeah. Now, yeah. Suppose we ourselves are negative, if we are not fit, do you think we will be able to give that support to our children? It will not be possible. So therefore, we need to look after our health in order to be able to give our children the best that we want to give. The role of parents is to provide support, encouragement, and access to activities that enable children to acquire the essential development skills. Parents are the first teachers of the children, and they should be the best teachers too. It is our responsibility as parents to protect our children from physical, social, and emotional harm. Let us not think that once I've admitted my child to the school, it is a responsibility of the principal and the teacher. No, parents, your responsibility is always there, I think, till the end of your life, perhaps I could say. So, therefore, we must expose them to the age-appropriate challenges. A child of 5 years should be exposed to the challenges she or he will face at that age. A child in teenage should be exposed to those problems. And throughout, we need to be there to encourage them and support them to explore on their own and learn from their interaction with the people around. Now, you may have the question as to how can we ensure the intellectual, emotional, and social development of our children. Most often, we parents usually limit the intellectual development to the 3 R's. The 3 R's, reading, writing, and arithmetic. But you must remember that in real life, it is much, much more different from that. Intellectual development focuses on the way changes occur in our brain relating to how we think and learn as we grow. So therefore, as children grow, the structure of their thinking also changes. And we as parents ought to remember that and understand and not expect our children who are teenagers to behave as they were behaving when they were small children. Quite often we hear them saying, oh, my child was a wonderful girl. She was such a darling, but now she is like this. It is just because I fail to realize that my child is growing up. So we must realize that as the child grows, there are changes and the child will need your support throughout, you may say, whatever it may be, because taking parental assistance is necessary, but not always telling them, you must inform me about everything. They do not like it. And gradually they will learn to be distancing themselves from you if you are insisting on all these things. So please remember that they need your support. You need to be there, they'll appreciate you. It is, so therefore, I think it is necessary for all of us to spend some time, some quality time with our children every day, interacting with them and observing them. Let me tell you, please abstain from imposing your views on your children. Advising is fine, but they need a reason. They will ask you why and be ready with the answer why. Please do not snub them saying that I have told you, so therefore you do it. No. If you explain to the child why it should be done, they will definitely listen to you. Because I have instances when the children have said, ma'am, please take moral sense for our parents, because they do not understand our question. They don't reply. So we need to be ready to reply why things have to be done. So parents, you need to guide them and provide them opportunities to explore new things. If your children are small, just about school going age, perhaps you can introduce them to the various home quizzes, like quiz about people in the house, people in the family, things found in the house, color of the things that are in the house, shapes of the things, sizes and things, so that child grows intellectually. As they grow, of course, we may have different things, but what I want to tell you is, it is necessary for you to spend quality time. Maybe sometime you need to take them out for an outing so that they spend time with nature. But spending time sitting in front of the television is no quality time. Quality time is that time where you have healthy interaction with your child. There is happiness, there is joy, there is fun and things like that. Now, so how do we think about the social and emotional development of our children? Healthy attachment with the parents is necessary to provide the child with a sense of safety and security when he or she faces problems. Remember always to stay attuned to your child to reassure and guide him or her so that they're able to cope with emotions. Empathy, soothing words are the need of the time, and no judgment. Please do not be judgmental to tell you are this, you are that. No, they are after all your child. So accept the child as she or he is, because she is your precious one. Teach your children self-esteem. Encourage them to get that self-esteem. Be there for your children to support them when they struggle to learn new skills. With your support and encouragement, I think they will feel supported and learn to appreciate themselves. Okay? They will also feel confident that their parents are always there to help them out. On the contrary, if you give some negative feedback, in whatever they do, it will cause them more of frustration and a sense of defeat. Children with such experience, according to my experience, are most likely to give up very easily because of low self-esteem and lack of confidence. So therefore, it is important that we keep a constant vigil on our children's behavior, keep a watch on them, and be alert to protect them when they are about to fall, or to protect them from the pitfalls. So when they're happy, you know, they are mixing with people, they're around. But when they're unhappy, you should be able to, sensible enough to understand something is going wrong with my child. My child must be having some problem. And when they get mad at simple things, you should know that the problem is getting a bit serious. Be alert, be around there. It is useless to cry later on over the spilled milk. You need to be there to guide and support once again with soothing words and compassion with your children. So when they are frustrated, you know, they will stop interacting with you, and then you really need very much, you know, to be with them. We also, I think, need to give them certain moral code. Like if you tell your child what behavior is acceptable and what is not acceptable, and explain to with the reason why it is not acceptable, I think the child will listen to you. Prepare your children for new social situation and teach them to interact appropriately with adults according to their age and the individuality with the people they interact with. So according to their age, that is small children or big children, according to their age, teach them to be empathetic towards the others. Please let us remember, do unto others what you want others to do to you. If you want others to be good to us, we need to be good to them. So please remember that. Now, we also think about the various ethical values we need to impart to our children, primarily honesty. Encourage your child to be honest, no matter how big the mistake may be. Let our relationship with our children be such that they feel confident that their parents will help them to sail through in difficult times, and definitely they will live without guilt. They will not. They will always come to you. They will tell you everything that happened in their life. If today you feel that your child doesn't share anything with you, it is just because you're not being receptive. You're not being available to your child. Teach them also to respect, because everyone loves to be respected. From young age, teach them to respect their elders, their peers, their siblings, people of different culture, people of different religions, because only when we respect others, we can expect others to respect us. Also, please teach them to be compassionate, to be sensitive to the needs of others. I've heard quite often parents saying, oh, I don't allow my child to do anything, I tell her to study. Believe me, when she comes to help you in the kitchen, and if you say, no, go and take your book, your child will be taking the book, but she'll be thinking something else. Rather, you could have allowed her to help you. You could have allowed your son to help you in cleaning your vehicle. You could have allowed your child, when the child came, say, volunteering, instead of sending them. So let them, teach them to be compassionate towards you, towards your family, towards a sibling, towards the relatives, as well as towards strangers, because sympathy, empathy, and compassion will pay back in the long run. What you teach them today, it will come back to you later. You teach the child to be sympathetic, the child will be sympathetic towards you later on in your life when you grow old. But suppose you told your child, no, you do your work, the child will do his or her work when you grow old also. You will not have your child to help you out. It is useless to blame them later on. My child is not bothered because I have not taught the child to be sympathetic and compassionate. Teach them also to stand up for justice. When things go wrong, I do not mean to say that they should speak out, because, yeah, it may be difficult to speak out for various reasons, but themselves being just is not difficult. You being just is not difficult, but don't expecting others to be just may be difficult. Teach them also to be forgiving, because abusing, hurting others will result in physical and emotional and mental agony. Encourage them to forgive and forget. If today we have so much violence around, the root cause is the unwillingness to forgive. The unwillingness to forgive, keeping that anger, the hatred, etc., in our heart for ages together leads to the violent behavior of the people. So if you want your child to be an exemplary child, you need to see that, you know, you imbibe in them those values. The religious tolerance is another important aspect that we need to teach them. Respect other religions, whichever religion to me, it is their choice. Just as my religion is my choice, others' religion is their choice. So if I respect others' religions, they will respect me. Finally, parents, I would like to tell you one most important advice, that is, keep your word. Keep your promise. Before you promise a child any reward, think before you promise and say whether it is possible. If it's possible alone, make a promise. And once you make a promise, keep your promise. So it should also be about the penalty. You have family rules. Please make certain family rules. And if one breaks the family rule, irrespective whether mommy, daddy, anyone, what is the penalty? Plan it with the family. With your children, you decide this is going to be the penalty. Maybe for parents, it's maybe a bit lesser, but I think there should be some penalty for them too, for breaking the rules. And for children, maybe on a little higher level, but stick to it. Do not say, this time I'll excuse you, because the children will learn to take advantage. What we sow, so we shall reap. What we teach, it will come back to us. Please remember that. Okay, because children pick our words and actions as pigeons pick peas, says John Gray. And it is true. They imitate us. They learn to do what we do. So if we live a healthy life, then children also will learn. Now, I told you that I will present some questions, and if you find positive answers about it, then you will be really happy. You can give a pat on your back, and here I share the screen. Please let me know if you are able to see it.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah? Okay.
Yes.
The question yourself. Do I feel confident to discuss my problem with my parents or confident? Think about it. If you feel confident, if you feel that there is someone who listens to you, well and good. Thumbs up to you. Do I spend time doing things I like and enjoy? Or I'm only worried about my work, my money, what income I get? Do I communicate with people around me or keep myself aloof? Do I have a good circle of friends around? Do I spend quality time with my children? More essential. Do I set aside some time for fun with my family? Do I take a break from my daily responsibilities? Some time for myself. I need to do that. Do I get enough sleep? If I don't get sleep, something is wrong. Do I welcome the new day happily? Or do I feel very lethargic? Oh my God, once again, another day of work. Do I feel confident that I can work through any problems? If you get at least 5 to 6 answers positive, yes, I can do all these things, then you don't have to worry about your stress, because stress is normal. We all undergo that stress. Now, I would like also to share the name of one book that, which I would like you to try to read. Try to read this book, Doing What Matters in Times of Stress. It's an illustrated guide by WHO, published in 2020. It is just 132 pages with illustrations, and it is available to read online. You can download it, and at your leisure, you can read it. I hope, I'm ready for any questions if you have regarding the teenage children. Thank you.
We'll have the questions during the question and answer session, ma'am.
Yeah.
Okay, the audience can keep their questions ready. Thank you very much, ma'am, for highlighting on the importance of having a good mental health and how as parents it is important to contribute to a balanced and healthy environment at home. The 21st century children will always ask for reasons, and we as adults must be ready to answer their whys without being judgmental. Your words will definitely help us in improving our relationships. The questionnaire was really helpful. Thank you, ma'am. Viewers, if you have any questions for Mrs. Teresa, please post them in the comment box. We will take them during the question and answer session. Women experience unique healthcare challenges. While catering to the needs of whole family, they tend to neglect their health. Herself and healthcare are very important. A healthy mind and a healthy body is extremely beneficial. I now request our next speaker, Dr. Girija Sanjay, to address us on the women health issues. Let me introduce Dr. Girija Sanjay to you. Dr. Girija Sanjay, MBBS DGO, is a consultant obstetrician and gynecologist at Dr. Mahadevappa Eye Laser Hospital. She is married to Dr. Sanjay, who is an eye surgeon. She completed her undergraduate and post-graduation from MR Medical College. Dr. Girija Sanjay is also a gold medalist. Dr. Girija Sanjay is practicing in Tumkur for 14 years. She has been very active part of ladies' wing in IMA, that is Indian Medical Association, and was a past president of Inner Wheel Club of Tumkur. She has delivered many talks in various institutions and colleges. Over to you, Dr. Girija.
Thank you so much, Halima. I think you can hear me.
Yes, yes.
Thank you for a wonderful introduction, and good evening to all the other speakers today, and also to the viewers. I think it was 15 days back, Mr. Khurshid approached me that they are going to arrange a webinar prior to the Women's Day, and he said to choose a topic. The most relevant to me was women and the health issues, because that will be a very good topic for me to enlighten the viewers about. So today I'll be addressing the viewers about the few health issues which the women face. Before that, I would like to wish all of you a very happy Women's Day in advance. Tomorrow we're going to celebrate it. But as the other speaker told, Mrs. Teresa, that we women should inspire each other. Then only it becomes women's empowerment. I totally agree with you, ma'am. When Mr. Khurshid told me that 10 minutes is the time limit, definitely, that's very short to address all the women's issues, because each organ itself takes whole day. So as much as possible, I'm trying to cover in this 10 minutes, which is allotted to me. And hopefully I will give you some take home messages which will benefit the viewers and even their parents or family members. As I've already told, that women are the pillar of the society. They are the foundation of a family. I always believe in a quote which I have posted in my chamber also, that the hand which rocks the cradle can rule the world also. So we women are capable of many lot of things. What we had went through a lot of repression during the earlier days, but now we are there in each and every field. But what happens ultimately is a woman keeps her own health in the last of her priority list, always neglects her own health. So whenever a person in the family is not well, a son, the father, the husband or the brother has always seen that we take care of those family members very well. We see to that they get the tea or their herbal drink or the medicines, everything on time. But do we take care of ourselves? I don't think so. Because always we see to that every other person of the family is attended to, but we don't attend to ourselves. We keep on postponing our doctor's appointment all the time. So ultimately, when something goes wrong with a very important female member of the family, the whole family crumbles down. They don't know how to handle the situation. So today I would definitely advise all the ladies over there to take care of themselves. First, self-care is very important. A woman's journey, a female journey, begins from the womb itself. So from the puberty to the menopause and even postmenopausal also, every female poses a lot of health issues. So as I told you, each and every topic itself takes a whole day. But I'll just tell you the concise part of what you can do at home. So when a girl attains puberty, very, very important is the family member, especially the mother. Before the puberty, you have to talk to the child about the bad touch and the good touch. We as now as a society, we have progressed a little, but initially we were very regressive. As a mother, we never felt it to share to the child that it is necessary to know what is a good and bad touch. Anybody can do it or inflict upon her injury by her bad luck. If a particular girl child suffers such a abuse in her childhood, it is definitely going to inflict a scar on her throughout her life. So pre-pubertal age, it's very, very important even for a tiny tot girl child or a boy child to explain. The mothers have to explain, or because mothers are quite close, so mother is an apt person to explain to them that what might go wrong, what is a good touch, and even how a very close family member also can inflict such abuses. And after the puberty, also so many of the teenage girls, they have a very wrong concept about the sexual education, be it that internal reproductive parts or external reproductive parts. They're never been explained in a proper scientific way why there is a why they shall attain a puberty, why there is a flow, what happens if the changes she can see in her bodily changes, even her mental changes and all. We try to hush up these things, which is not a right thing to do. We have to explain them. It's just a normal physiological change which is happening in a particular body. It is nothing pathologic, nothing unclean or horrible about it. We should definitely, this is a very tender age for them, where there is a raging hormones in their body. They'll feel all sort of changes in their physical as well as their mental well-being. So if you don't educate your child what is going to happen to her, then can't expect them to. Then what do they do is they go on to Google, which is very easily available in everybody's phone nowadays. And Google gives you half knowledge, which is very, very dangerous. They don't know what is, and they get influenced by the social media and also by the these TV series and movies which show all wrong concepts. So as a parent, as a mother, as a family, I mean, mother is the one who would definitely connect with the child. You have to explain to your girl child what happens in her body and how she should adapt to it, how everything is normal. She is not an unclean person during this menstruation. What is the physiology? What is the science behind it? That all should be brought to her notice. Nowadays, it's much better. But when we were all young, it was definitely a taboo. Nobody wanted to address it. And definitely, you should give a sex education also. What are the other... You can't do it because you cannot connect to your child. Definitely get through a doctor, her sex education done. Nowadays, so many counselors are there in sex education also. They should have a basic knowledge. Otherwise, they will develop very wrong concepts in their future. That is very, very important. Once the child knows everything is scientific, everything is normal, everything is physiological, definitely she'll have a clear picture in her mind. That doesn't bother her, and she'll be clear of all the wrong concepts which are so much flowing over the social media now. Next, I would tell the age group of, and also you should explain to these teenagers the importance of nutrition, the importance of exercises, because nowadays we see childhood obesity, which is a very, very wrong trend being followed from the Western countries. Initially, when we were girls, we had to always walk to a school and help our mothers. And even the diet was not centered around the child. It was like every whole of the joint family is eating the same thing, and even the child is going to eat the same thing. Now, because of the junk food available and everywhere, just you can order online to your home also, and it is very tasty. The children can order anything online, and even we as parents give in to their demands, and then they become couch potatoes. They settle onto the TV or a phone. They don't want to go. They are ready to play the online games, but and meet virtual friends, but they're not ready for the outside world friends and all. We used to play so much. We never spent our evenings at home. Till 7 o'clock, we were outside enjoying all our games. But nowadays, it is not the same. Now we are ready to send, nor they are ready to go, and they land. It's definitely a big nuisance, the childhood obesity. So you have to explain to them about not being size zero or overweight. You have to explain to about diet and the exercise. They have to follow some exercise, because diabetes, hypertension, all these metabolic syndrome diseases, and even in girls, especially the menstrual problems like PCOD, is setting very early. Very early. Nowadays, the pregnant ladies coming with diabetes and hypertension is a headache to the gynecologist. So we have to tutor them what is the importance of the healthy lifestyle so that they follow it in the long term. Next comes the age group of this around 25 years. So nowadays, in the name of being too progressive, we ladies also, many of the females are into smoking, drinking in the metropolitan cities, and they're not into good habits. And because of all this late night hour of working, the sleep is not right, their diet is not right, they don't want to eat anything healthy, they go for instant food. So all this is going to definitely affect their health. So when you see new Western countries, usually the checkups start very early for the female child. Around 18 years, they get their cervarix vaccine. Now, that is a vaccine which is known up to 80% to prevent the cervical cancer in future. Because sexual life starts very early in the Western countries, it should be given before the sexual encounter, first encounter. So it's given around 13 to 14 years of age. That is the vaccine for cervical cancer. Now it is available in India also. And Indian girls also, all the mothers out there, and whoever is listening to this webinar, I would request you to definitely go and ask your doctor, gynec, about this vaccine for cervical cancer. In India, definitely the children, the girls are a little more definitely delayed in their sexual encounters before the virus infects the her genital organs. If the vaccine is given, it is a very easy thing, and you can ask your gynec about more details of this vaccine. Next comes, like, when should a lady go to a doctor for her checkup? We always see that we have a fear in our mind that if you go to a doctor, if you go to your gynec, she'll do all sorts of examination and she'll terrorize you with all sorts of tests and examinations. So better not to go. Please don't do that. So what you can do at home sitting is, after 35 years, you see to that, you go to your doctor, gynec, every 3 years. Make it a mandatory thing. Put it in your protocol. Okay. Now, what we do there, when you visit a doctor, what we do there, your vitals, like blood pressure, pulse is checked. We observe for your thyroid and we examine your breast. And also, we will take out a pap smear. Now, I'll tell you in short, what is a pap smear? Everyone has a wrong concept in their mind. First of all, is pap smear is a smear. See, I have to just tell you, is only one internal organ of a female which we can see properly is her cervix. That is the mouth of the uterus. Only that we gynecs can see by putting a speculum. There we can detect the early cancerous changes. So about 35, you come every 3 years to us, then we can see any change. We'll take a pap smear, we'll take a smear from that particular part and send it for testing. It is a very simple procedure which we do in our OPD only. No need of any admission. And it's just a 5 minutes procedure, and immediately we'll send for testing. By evening, you'll be relieved to find that it is a normal. If you have any problems, definitely it is not deadly cancer. It is definitely different levels of treatments are available for everything. So pap smear every 3 years, about 35, is a must. For that, you have to visit a gynec, and it is a very simple procedure. It is done on an OPD basis, only of 2 to 5 minutes, and then the test results are available by evening. I would advise all the ladies out there to also examine their breasts. SBE, self-breast examination, is most important. When you should do this, you should be taught from 18 years of age for the kid only. So every 2 months, you have to stand in front of the mirror. When you should do your breast examination, don't do it before periods. Do it after periods, once 5th or 7th day, once your periods are completed. Before periods, if you do, the hormone progesterone will be acting. So that will make your breast tender and painful. And you'll feel suddenly lumps. You'll feel that, oh, I have a lump in my breast. So that is not the right time. Do it after your periods are completed. So when you should do, before going to bath, you have a mirror in your bathroom. Just, or if you're in your room, just you have to be naked till the breast. Examine them first. Examine them. See if there is any change in size or something. After that, palpate. You have to feel your breast in all the parts. How to do? Don't use your fingertips. Always fingertips will cause pain. Okay, and suddenly you will feel some nodules. Use the palm of your fingers. Gently feel all the quadrants of your breast. Okay, and lastly, press your nipples. So if you feel for any discharge, if you feel any discharge is there, if you feel there is some lump, some mass, immediately consult your gynec. Every 2 months, every lady, every female should do this. Cervical cancer was the first cancer leading the top. Then comes the breast cancer. But now the change has happened. Because our whole unhealthy lifestyle, the ladies are getting breast cancer very early. India is on a rising trend. So this simple examination of self-breast examination every 2 months by your own self, in your room, privacy of room, is a must. Please take home message. Yes. Okay. The next thing is, once you cross your 40 years, every 2 years you have to visit your doctor. She'll do all these tests again. She will advise you for blood tests. Nowadays, we see young girls are for around 22 years suffering from diabetes mellitus, obesity, hypertension, and another very important is PCOD, polycystic ovarian syndrome or disease, where she develops all this unhealthy hair, and also she'll develop irregular menstrual cycles and obese, and she's has mood swings and all. So that should be tackled very early. Otherwise, it leads to a lot of cancers and problems, infertility in the future. So you have to get the blood test done above 40 years. Every 2 years, your lipids are checked, cholesterol is checked, and your basic thyroid function, and your sugar levels are checked. If it is normal, well and good. If not, we are always there. And a pap smear is done, breast examination done, and a mammography. Mammography is a test where the cancer in the breast is detected in a very, very early stage, but is less than 5 mm in diameter. So get a mammography done every, not 2 years at least, every 4 years after 40. And also your bones. Indian women are known to develop osteoporosis and arthritis. Very frequently we see ladies with arthritis problems. So her calcium levels and her bone density has to be checked. So BMD, bone mineral deposit testing also is available in even every small towns also nowadays. So all these checkups are very important to prevent your problems. Every age of a female has one or the other problems. Even in our postmenopausal, menopause itself is a huge topic nowadays. She'll have all sorts of hot flushes, irritability, mood swings, and dryness in her whole body. She feels she's weak. Her all this skin, the things, everything going wrinkled, dry. She feels her family is neglected. The mental health problems also start. So what you should take care even during your age above 60 also, above 50 also, when you're in the postmenopausal era, you have to go for the vitamins, calcium supplements, and definitely get your cardiac workup done. Because estrogen, which is an important hormone to protect the heart, is not there. Because after your menopause, it dips down. So when it dips down, you're as prone to cardiac disease as any other man. So your cardiac workup is very, very important. Like ECG has to be done, an echo has to be done, a stress test has to be done above your 50 years. So this is a very shortly I have presented. Very important for all age group is even your attained menopause, your a walk also is enough. A daily walk, maintain a daily routine and take care of your health. Go to your gynec. Don't think that I've done with my menopause now. I don't have to go to gynec. Don't be under the impression. Maintain to go at least twice in a year. I tell every patient of mine and even the other attenders that what shall I give to my mother, sister, mother-in-law, or my wife for this Women's Day? I say, don't go for diamonds. Don't go for very good clothes, or don't take her on a vacation. Do that. Do all those things. But very important, give her a health card. Go take her for a health checkup. Very, very, she is there to support the whole family. Then definitely the family will be taken care of by her. So to it today, all the women I request you is, please keep your self-care on the top of your priority list. And I request all the family members to ensure that the females of your family are taking care of themselves in every way. And it's really being an honor for me to speak on this subject today. Though I don't know whether I've done justice because a short period I got. Anyways, if I have given some take-home messages, I'll be very glad. I once again thank Mr. Khurshid and Halima and also the work organization for giving me this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Girija, for helping us build a positive and healthy body. Your tips will help us improve our health and our lifestyles. Physical activities and healthy eating habits should be a routine for all of us. Thank you for highlighting on how sex education is important today. The regular checkups will definitely help us maintain our health, and the tips on the self-checkup that you gave were awesome. Thank you so much. I request the audience to share their feedback or question in the comment box. This competitive world is driving us crazy. Depression, one of the dangerous and serious illness, is taking a toll on our lives. It drains our energies, leaving us feel empty and fatigued. It negatively affects our feelings, thought process, and behavior, driving us from being sad to lose interest in activities that once we would enjoy the most. Fortunately, it is treatable. I now invite Ms. Rajeshwari to empower us in fighting with depression. Ms. Rajeshwari, Director, Ajna Counseling and Training, is a psychological counselor, soft skill and life skill trainer. After working with the corporate world for over a decade, her passion towards working for social cause drew her to the field of psychology and training. She had the opportunity of training students at more than 15 engineering colleges on the topic corporate preparedness and has conducted workshops on topic prevention of sexual harassment at workplace. Her concern towards child safety has made her to empower many children in schools to protect themselves from sexual abuse. She also conducts sexuality workshops to college students. She has trained employees of various organizations on team building, conflict management, stress management, leadership, emotional intelligence, and many more. Ms. Rajeshwari is a counselor for sexual harassment cell committees, that is Bar Council of Karnataka, Bangalore, and Malige Hospital. She is a lead trainer at Faith Foundation India, an organization which is working towards creating awareness against child sexual abuse. She is an associate faculty at Banjara Academy and is a certified career coach. Over to you, Ms. Rajeshwari.
Thank you so much, Halima. And Mrs. Teresa and Dr. Girija Sanjay, definitely threw a lot of light on the prevention board, right? What care we need to be taking and how we should be working on ourselves and how to actually avoid anyone dysfunctional mode. So now today what I'm speaking about is both. One is the prevention and another one is the awareness. So my topic is fighting depression. I would just want to generally ask everyone, when we just say that, you know, it's a commonly used word, I am feeling so depressed, I don't want to do this, I don't want to do that. And you ask a 7 or 8 years old child, the child also says, I'm feeling so sad and depressed. You know, you can actually listen to, the children also saying those kind of words. But that's all in the normal realm of life, you know. So if a child has lost expensive, eraser, the child can feel sad. And, you know, since the child has heard this term depressed, I have heard, children saying this, I have lost this, I'm feeling so low, I'm feeling so depressed. And a little higher in the age group, you know, if you just go into the age group of 10, 11, 12, you know, it's a different kind of, the sadness. It probably if the birthdays are not celebrated the way they want, and they cannot distribute the goodies, what they want to their friends, or they didn't get the proper goodies for their birthday, or, they don't get the dress, the dream dress, what they are looking at. Or with regard to boys, they don't get their dream car, the racing car or whatever, you know. There are signs of that sadness and they might feel a little low. And if you go a little higher in the ladder of adolescent, life, the first crush, if they don't get, you know, they might feel a little low. Right? Or the first crush or the first, the relationship which it didn't work, they might feel a little low. If you go a little higher in the ladder of the age group, when the people get into the adult life, they didn't get the right course, right college, right spouse, right husband, right job, you know, whatnot. You know, we all start feeling, but then each one of us are resilient, is it not? You know, we have our own way of coping mechanism. We're all blessed with that coping mechanism. Right? We kind of deal with that and we kind of, handle that. So we can call that we all might have these spells of the so-called the normal depressive episodes and we kind of come out of it. So today what actually I'm going to be probably throwing a light based on my experience is the depression what the people go through, probably we could term that as the clinical depression or the medical depression is what, I would just be throwing a light on. So what is this medical depression, what I'm talking about? It's a common or a serious disorder or illness that affects the way you feel, that affects the way you think, and that affects the way you act. Okay, so and it'll also have the, you know, kind of effect on the behavioral aspects with regard to your emotions, with regard to your actions, your thoughts and things like that. It will also have a bearing on your body. So we call this as, you know, the psychosomatic, effect of the events. And as this progresses, probably we could term this as the depressive disorders. You know, there are so many kind of depressive disorders. And I think Dr. Girija Sanjay and the experienced counselor like Teresa will kind of understand that it's a huge broad spectrum. But today, let me have the scope of my talk to fighting depression with women. Right. Let me just address that. There are certain manuals which has been given by in the psychiatrist arena, what we call it as DSM manual, and there they have defined what depressions are and what are the symptoms of the depression, what is the cause for depression, and what is the treatment for depression, and what should be and what can be the prognosis of this particular kind of disorder what we are talking about. So let me just address this. Let me not go into the technical aspect of what has been stated in the DSM manual, but I will just be basing my talk on what has been mentioned in the DSM manual. Generally, it does have certain kind of symptoms. You know, let's understand what the symptoms are. The symptoms could be kind of prolonged sadness, prolonged withdrawal from any activity. You're feeling very, very low within yourself for a long spell of time. Now, this is highly relative. You know, it could be 2 months, it could be 3 months, or it could be 6 months. But, you're not in a position to come out of that on your own, whatever amount of motivation, whatever people are speaking about, it's not just, they're not enough for you to motivate, So that is one of the things. Then there could be either the weight loss or the weight gain. Both could be there, because when a person is feeling depressed, we are all driven by a lot of, neurotransmitters in our brain. So any variation of that will have a lot of imbalances with regard to the secretions, what is happening. So one such, the harmful, the neurotransmitter, what we call it, could be the cortisol. If the cortisol spiking is happening, we don't know what could be the effect of the cortisol spiking. I'm sure Dr. Girija will agree with me. It can lead into a lot of disorders like the hypertension or diabetes or any organ failure, because it's we all need cortisol for the normal functioning, because that gives it's called a stress hormone, but we all need to add that certain kind of the stress hormone in our lives to function normally. But what is the limit? If it goes beyond a certain limit, I'm not very sure what could be the limit of the cortisol, what I'm speaking about. But if it goes beyond a certain functional limit, it can definitely lead into a lot of complications. So that is what we call it as somatization of what we are thinking and what we are feeling and what we are acting. If it is negative, it can definitely have a bearing on your body, right? So definitely what you think, what you eat, how you live, what you speak will definitely have a bearing on your body. That's how I understand, the psychology or the neurology part of how your thinking affects your body. So as a layman, I would want to present this topic. Now, if we just go a little further, typical symptoms where I have come across with the people of depression, they will feel that, oh God, I'm so worthless. Can I do it? I just cannot do it. They will have lack of confidence and lack of self-esteem. They feel that they are worthless. Their self-worth is at a very, very rock bottom. They will, because of that, they will not be in a position to set goals for themselves. They'll not be in a position to work for themselves and things like that. Or they will also be not in a position to take decisions positively, for themselves. So this is one of the things. And there is an excessive sense of guilt, and probably they will also have, the feeling of
suicide, right? So not every depression person will have a sense of suicide, but you know, there is a constant thought of, you know, I don't want to leave, I'm not worth leaving, and nobody likes me, and I'm not worth their love, or they are not worth my love, and things like that. You know, this goes on, you know, there is a huge list of it. But many a times all of us feel this. What is the disclaimer here is, this thought process or this spectrum, what I'm talking about, should be there for a prolonged period of time. Minimum, say, for example, 8 weeks or 12 weeks, you know, or between 3 to 6 months is what they say that. And that's the time when they actually kind of say, okay, probably this is a case of depression or a clinical depression. Now, how should we treat this clinical depression? One is, it has to be, it's to do with a lot of chemical reactions in our body and mind that has to be suppressed and that has to be taken care. So hence, we need the psychiatrist's help. When I say psychiatrist, they are the people who are supposed to be giving the medicines, not the psychologist or the psychotherapist. So we will, the person who is undergoing this, first of all, will have to contact a psychiatrist, and he or she should be presenting himself or herself to a psychiatrist, present her case, and allow herself or himself to be observed in terms of you know, building the case, in terms of understanding, in terms of going through blood tests and so many things. They will have to really build a case history and observe, and probably the treatment starts from there. So that is one aspect of it. The other aspect of it, we all know that our brain is very plastic, you know, how we train, so it, you know, kind of changes, right? And at any age, you know, that, you know, brain is highly plastic, that, you know, the plasticity of the brain allows itself to be trained. So that's when the psychotherapist or the psychologist intervene to kind of constantly get into the lifestyle change, right? So it could be in terms of, you know, rectifying the faulty thinking. That can be a habit, right? Or in terms of rectifying the complete life, you know, the routines, what you're going to be working with. Or it could be in terms of the food and so many things, right? These are all this comes through the learning experiences. I think all of you agree that we are all driven by the nature and the nurture factor. The nature factor, the psychiatrists can take care, they can correct, probably get into the corrective mode for the electronics part within our body or with inside, and we can actually take care of the software part of it, you know, the thinking pattern. That's how I identify, the electronics and the software within us. So we can actually work with them to kind of take care of how they think, and probably work with them to get their counterintuitive thought processes or counterthinking thought processes. And we have so many therapies for that. We have cognitive based therapy or behavioral therapy or the rational emotive based therapies and so on and so forth. So any one of the therapies can be administered to kind of counter the medicines part of it and also take care of the behavioral aspects. So this is one of the ways the interventions can be given for the person who is fighting depression. But when we come to the women, right? Generally, depressive kind of symptoms sets in probably after a person has attained adolescent life. Generally with children, they are still growing, their thinking processes are getting refined, their thought processes are getting defined, and they are still not in a position to take decisions for themselves for probably various reasons. But the onset of depression can be identified with the onset of adolescence. I'm talking about the clinical depression cases, not in the normal spectrum, right? So it can go, from there it can start. Probably the onset of puberty, the hormonal imbalances can also put a person into a certain kind of thought process that could be a clinically driven kind of a situation, or with the onset of the adulthood or sudden life changing of events, say, for example, the marriage itself, you know, in case we have all come across for ladies, particularly, there is a sudden change in events. There is a sudden change in the dimension of relationships. There is a kind of the marriage can also be affecting a person positively. The marriage can also be affecting a person with so many other kind of adjustments, what the person will have to be doing for himself, you know, for herself. So this can also be one such thing which can definitely, you know, lead a person into the depressive kind of situation. I'm just giving some extreme cases where it can actually set in. And the other the aspect of the you know, womanhood is we call this as postpartum syndrome. After a person has given birth to a child, generally many ladies get into this kind of postpartum depression, right? And that can some people overcome that very, very early, but for few people, definitely they need medical intervention. This is also one, or even during the pregnancy cycle itself, suddenly so much of activities has changed, and suddenly the life has thrown a person off beat, you know, those kind of things. And even the postpartum you know, experiences could be the self-image, the body image is also kind of, you know, working in a different way, because ladies go through a lot of bodily changes after the pregnancy, after the childbirth. And that can be a sudden change in the event. So that can also cause, you know, depressive symptoms in ladies particularly. As we go a little up the ladder, you know, your menopause could be one thing which can actually put a person into, you know, the depressive state. I think Dr. Girija was also mentioning about it with regard to taking care of self. With regard to menopause, there are a lot of changes, a lot of concerns which will be happening. But generally, ladies can slip into the depressive state even at this state of time itself. She was mentioning very beautifully about what can cause with regard to cancer and things like that. Even at menopause, a lot of, you know, care has to be taken with regard to constant medical checkups and hygiene and this and that, and so many aspects we will have to be taking care of. And also, there is a certain kind of empty nest kind of a situation what every human being goes through. We call this as the midlife crisis, or you know, somewhere at the onset of 40 and 50 years, again, ladies' body, mind, you know, a lot of changes happen, and they just will not be in a position to accept that sudden changes happening. So many people will actually feel depressed even at this point in time, and it can go into severe depression also. And later on, when the children are away, when the spouse is on its own, and you have got your, you know, menopause, and there is a certain kind of, you know, stop to your sexual activity, right? And suddenly you feel you're not important. Nobody wants you. Nobody wants to take care of you. And you have given so much to the people around, and there is no one who can take care of you. That kind of a situation where we call this as emptiness kind of a situation. This is also one such situation where ladies can get into depression. So as such, every human being is, and also I would want to add a few more. They, you know, the other common reasons could be sudden loss of someone whom we love the most, or sudden loss of, you know, a change in your career, and probably your retirement, and probably, you know, position changes for any lady. And a lot of things. And also with regard to the ladies particularly, few of the cases which I would really want to mention here is, I do have a lot of counseling cases where, you know, they are the victims of the child sexual abuse, right? They have gone through the abuse, and because they have the right knowledge, as Dr. Girija was mentioning, of taboo attached to it, lot of myths attached to it, half knowledge, and the guilt driven by what has happened in their age, they wouldn't be vocal about what happened to them with the people around. So what happens, this actually would have led into what we call it as adverse childhood experience, which would have allowed a person to take wrong decisions for themselves. One such wrong decision is not speaking about it, right? We could call it wrong decision, but then our society also kind of creates such an environment where they fear being judged, they fear being labeled. Instead of supporting and removing the guilt and shame from the person, we add more of guilt, more of shame, more of labeling, right? So hence they are not in a position to talk. So this adverse childhood experience has led to take the faulty decisions for themselves. Hence they have also got into the depressive states. And not just this, because of that, because of whatever has happened in the past, it can also have a rippling effect in their relationships around also. They can also pass on this kind of behavior to the next generation, to the daughter, to be overtly protective and things like that, So these are some of these, situations where the lady can go through a lot of traumatic kind of experiences. So what I mean to say is trauma is also one such thing. The post-traumatic situations are also, one such thing which can actually propel a person to get into the depressive state of, mind. So the answer to all this is awareness is a key. Right, we'll have to understand what we are going, and most importantly is share what's happening to you with someone whom you love. And the good news is depression is treatable. That's the good news. It's treatable, though it can take time, because we are dealing with the mind space and the brain and the behavior. Right, so it can take little time, but the good news is you can overcome this. And with that note, I would just want to leave it to the next speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Rajeshwari, for your empowering words, for instilling hope in us in overcoming depression and not giving up. We as individuals will be able to make a difference to ourselves and to others' lives. Brain can be trained and we can rectify our thought process. I think we must all go through the DCM manual to know more about depression. Identifying and seeking medical advice will also help us in fighting depression. Thank you so much, ma'am. I request our audience to share their feedback or question in the comment box. Please do mention the name of the speaker. You can tell the condition of a nation by looking at the status of its women, quoted by Jawaharlal Nehru. For most of us, faith forms the moral and ethical framework within which societies operate. India has been predominantly a spiritual nation. Faith plays an important role here. Faith is shaped by culture and spiritual laws of God. When we unfold or discover these laws, we get the answers to the unlimited questions of life. Faith can be used in bringing drastic changes in one's life. I request the speakers to please mute their mics. Thank you. Faith can be used in bringing drastic changes in one's life. It helps us in dealing with challenges of life. I call Sister Nazia Kausar to shed some light on how faith affects women. Let me introduce Sister Nazia to you. Sister Nazia is an active member of work and a student of faith. She has completed BSc in Computer Science from Mount Carmel College, Bangalore. She has rich experience in teaching at schools. She has served as a headmistress of Vatican School, Bangalore, and has also been an academic head for Alarafa School, Bangalore. Spirituality, healing, meditation are her area of interest. She is active in interfaith discussion and clarification on issues related to faith. Over to you, Sister Nazia.
Thank you, Sister Alima. May peace, mercy, and blessings be upon you all. It is such an overwhelming feeling to be a part of this webinar. Sister Teresa, Sister Girija, and Sister Rajeshwari have covered the most important aspects of a woman's life, physical, emotional, and mental well-being. I would like to continue this process by covering the spiritual aspect of a woman's life. Gregory Peck rightly said, faith gives you an inner strength and a sense of balance and perspective in life. I require 2 seconds. I will be sharing my screen. Are you able to see my screen?
Not yet, ma'am.
I just hold.
Yes, I'm able to see.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for the patience. Okay, faith forms a moral and ethical framework within our society. It is what helps us to keep going. In the toughest of times, it gives us strength. It illuminates the path in times of darkness. With faith, people have moved mountains and tamed uncharted seas. Mahatma Gandhi has encompassed the power of belief quite comprehensively. Your belief becomes your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your habits, and your habits become your values. Your values become your destiny. So it is very important for us to keep a watch on our beliefs. It is important to realize how faith can either raise us to the heights of success or sink us to the depth of darkness. We need to analyze the belief system that has been passed on to us from generations using logic, critical thinking, and scientific temper. As we are here on the Women's Day celebration, I am here to speak on how faith and culture affects women. As faith is a double-edged sword, we have both positive as well as negative aspects of faith. India identifies itself as a spiritual nation. Yoga, meditation, etc. has their roots enriched from India. Culture and faith plays a very important role in our well-being. Correct faith adds value and peace to life, whereas blind faith brings havoc to the society. Correct faith elevates the status of women, whereas false faith degrades it. It is an open truth that it is a male-dominated society. Culture and faith plays an important role in this domination. Fear of religion and honor in the name of culture has been used against women. History and data speaks volumes about how women have been suppressed in this society. Let me explain by examples. Satiprata. We all know Satiprata existed a few years ago, where a female was forced to jump into the pyre of her husband, and she would be burnt alive. With time, a civil society, upon logical introspection, came to the realization and that this belief was morally wrong, and they came to end it. Likewise, Dahej Prata is still a curse with us. It silently exists even today. Daily, around 20 deaths takes place around India, either forcefully or by suicide. Recently, we came across a case of Aisha from Gujarat who committed suicide by jumping into the river. She even recorded a video before jumping into the river. And there she has explained how she was forced for dowry harassment. it was just a part of culture and not a divine teaching. Education and job in our society, especially the Muslim society. The level of education and employment is very low in Muslims. Due to the ignorance of the teachings of the Holy Quran and the teachings taught by the Prophet, people have wrongly assumed that educating women is something undesirable. The statistics speak for itself. These are from the Government of India. Literacy rate of Muslim women lower than the women of any other group. This has been attributed to faith, and that's why people have gone wrong analyzing what is right and what is wrong. Female infanticide, Devdasi Pratha, etc. are still prevalent in our society, which is much more governed by faith and traditions. Several wrong teachings are still prevalent. Women are inferior to men. Women must be subservient to their husbands, no matter how much they oppress. Women need to be controlled as they are incapable of self-governance. But wait, this is not the complete picture. As I mentioned, faith is a double-edged sword. If it is not used in the right form, it can bring revolution. If it is used in the right form, it can bring revolution in our society. The faith that there is a divine being watching us, our actions, can make us more accountable to our deeds. It helps us to become more positive towards our fellow beings. It helps us to take care of the orphans. It helps us in feeding the hungry. It helps us to restrain from corruption. It helps us in controlling anger. It helps us in upholding justice. Just a feeling that one supreme is governing us. This brings order and social cohesion in the society, which makes social interactions meaningful and satisfying. It is well documented that people who have faith in a supreme power find meaning, hope, comfort, and inner peace in their lives, and statistically enjoy longer and healthier lives. The beliefs of Sati Pratha, etc., were wrongly attributed to the Creator, and they were not the true teachings of God. And that is why with time people realized it and stopped practicing them. Same way in Arab also, a girl was buried alive. As soon as a girl would be born, the Arabs would feel ashamed that a girl is born and they would hide themselves. This practice was stopped when God Almighty sent an instruction saying that when a daughter is announced to one of them, his face becomes black and he is full of wrath. He hides himself from the people when it is announced to him. Shall he keep it with disgrace or bury in the earth? Now surely evil is what they judge. Quran 17:31. For us, when you hear, it sends shiver down my spine just by hearing that a female would be buried alive just as she was in, as soon as she would come into the hands. How is it even possible? It is very difficult to even realize, that such practices exist. Even today, faith is a blessing if used correctly. Is it possible that faith in the ultimate truth can take us in wrong direction? Effective faith can bring revolution in life. We have the potential faith. How do we put this to use effectively? Some of the positive aspects of faith are that if a person has faith, and he recovers faster compared to the person who has no faith. We all know that even with deadly diseases, patients who had faith have recovered very fast and who have even survived to give us the testimonies that they are alive because of faith. Meditation brings peace and comfort, forgiveness and gratitude. As we have discussed many of the issues related to women, I think most of the issues can be dealt with if we learn to forgive. I know we are not forgiving for the benefit of the others, but we are forgiving it for the benefit of ourselves. Much of the stress gets reduced. Much of the pain is gone. We do not carry it for long. So forgiveness helps us in relieving our own pressures, and gratitude. Gratitude helps us to look at the people who are lower than us and gives us a sense of satisfaction and happiness. it helps us to actually look at the blessings that has been bestowed upon us. Even a smallest thing like oxygen is very important in life, especially now in corona era. When we look at people, like oxygen cylinder costs so much, but we have been given oxygen for free. Not only oxygen, for that matter, water, life sustaining, all forces, we have been provided it for free. So gratitude, when you look at small things and place gratitude for all these things, it really helps us. Even though we do not have like faith in such things, cause a great deal of help in our society. Faith also helps in reaching our goals. There are two questions we need to ask ourselves. Whatever belief we have, is this belief or tradition really a part of God's guidance? If it was, how is it possible? How is it beneficial to me and to the society at large? How divine guidance can help? We have been bestowed with intellect, which we can use to find out if it is right or wrong, what should be right, what should be wrong. If it is right, we choose it, and if it is wrong, we give it up. Scientific knowledge. We have all seen that science is nothing but the laws of God, established facts. Once the facts are established, it is nothing but it is the laws of the universe. We can use our intellect and the scientific knowledge to differentiate between what is actually the faith and what is beneficial to us, and what is the cultural practices that we need to give it up. The instructions of God can be understood using common sense and intellect. We need to have a positive mindset and rational approach which will help us to fight blind faith. Women should also realize that being good does not mean that we take everything that is thrown to us. We can still be good by taking a stand against wrong practices. It is time we should investigate and analyze the belief system that has been slapped upon us since generations in the name of faith and tradition, and to accept only that which is logical and beneficial to us and our society. To sum up, a woman is an architect of this society. She is the pillar upon which the entire family stands, the entire nation stands. Her strength contributes in making an ideal family, ideal society, and an ideal state. Avoid incorrect faith and false traditions. Avoid exploitations. If we can follow the faith and if we can avoid the incorrect faith and false traditions, we can avoid in exploitations. I've already mentioned earlier, like what do we need to look at to avoid exploitations. We need to use the power of the right faith to be liberated. Sister Teresa has almost covered up most of the things that we need to have as a strong mental well-being of a person. If we have the right values given to us, as mother is the main person who gives the values to the children, it is very important that right values are given to the children so that, you know, they know to differentiate between right and wrong. At the same time, she also covered like how a mother or a family can be the strength, especially to the girl children or children on the whole. A family needs to be the strength. If the family stands as a strength, the girls can take any amount of stress or any amount of thing, provided they know that there is someone to lean at and someone to provide support for. Especially in the case like dowry and all, we as a society, what we do is we instead of giving support to our family and our kids, we are more worried like what the world will think, what the society will have the opinion about. We are only concerned about how a society thinks of And instead of that, I think as parents, we can say, okay, no, no matter what, we are there for you. We have already given the right values. And now it is time when our kids are on the right, in the right direction, it is time for us to stand with them and support them and give them the strength they need to stand the difficult times in the society. Her strength contributes in making an ideal family, ideal society, and an ideal state. That is why it is very important to have a right faith to prevent exploitation and oppression. As Halima already stated Jawaharlal Nehru saying, the position of women in any society is the indicator of the health of the state. So it is very important that the women's well-being is taken care of in any state for it to be a progressive state. I would like to end my talk by saying, a strong and a learned woman can build strong nations. Thank you.
It was very nice. Thank you, Sister Nazia, for enlightening us on the power of faith. You have highlighted how blind faith has exploited women. We understand that it is the faith which makes a difference in the world. It helps us in establishing peace and harmony in an individual's life as well as in the society. I request our audience to share your feedback or question in the comment box. Life is meaningful only if it is serving the purpose. Many beautiful souls in this world are trying to do their best to bridge the gaps between our hearts. One such organization is WORK. I invite Sister Noora and Samina to introduce WORK and its activities to all of us. Sister Samina is an active member of WORK. She pursued her education from Jyoti Nivas College, Bangalore. She believes in rendering a hand to the needy and make a difference in others' lives by spending her time in social service activities. Over to you, Sister Samina.
Thank you, Halima Sadia. May peace, mercy, and blessings of God Almighty be on all of you. WORK is the abbreviation for the World Organization of Religions and Knowledge. WORK is a volunteer-based pan-India organization, and all its members are volunteers. In accordance with the name WORK, the members of volunteers are called workers. Hatred, divisions, and discrimination in mankind is mainly on the basis of religion, caste, creed, and color. This organization was established to unite mankind under the umbrella of humanity on the basis of one God and one parentage, that is Adam and Eve. The main guiding principles of this organization are compassion. WORK as an organization strives to instill compassion in the hearts of people to help create an interconnected society living together as one. Delivering the message of peace. The volunteers work day and night to deliver the message of peace among the people to make the world a better place to live in. The five focused principles are Shanti, that is peace, Ekta, unity, Seva, service to humanity, Gyan, acquiring knowledge, and Sahyog, cooperation. The founder of this organization was Maulana Shams Naved Usmani, a saint and a noble soul. He dedicated his life to the Creator for reforming humanity by bringing them closer to the Lord and to each other. An avid scholar of Islamic, Hindu, Christian, Buddhist, Jain, and Sikh scriptures, he started working on communal harmony and peace. Sayyid Abdullah Tariq, born 1953, is the lifetime president Pan India of this organization. An electrical engineer by qualification, his search for truth came to an end as he met Maulana Shams Naved Usmani. Since 1987, Sayyid Abdullah Tariq decided to dedicate his life for the matter of unity, humanity, and compassion. He is a leading scholar of Quran, Ved, Gita, Puran, Bible, and Guru Granth Sahib. He served as a guest faculty member of the Indian Institute of Management, Ahmedabad, for over 15 years to teach entrepreneurship. He has been invited by all major religious groups like the Sanatan Dharma, Brahma Kumari, Arya Samaj, Nirankari Mission, Gayatri Parivar, and various Christian groups to discuss common grounds and promote communal harmony amongst the people. Further, he has been into reforming jail inmates through his lectures in prisons around the country. He has been honored with several prestigious awards for his role in communal harmony. He has also authored several books. Berg has branches in all the major states in the country. The state leader of the Karnataka chapter is Mr. Khurshid Imam. He and his team have been working among the people of Karnataka since a decade, striving to provide the healing touch to the suffering humanity, interacting with people of different faiths and bridging the gap in the society, regularly organizing programs that benefit the society. Here are some snapshots of the activities taken up by the Karnataka chapter in 2020 and 2021. Old age home visit. This was an initiative from the Bangalore work team. We visited an old age home of 25 people and distributed food, donated groceries, medical supplies, and other things. We spent time with them and also shared meals. Alhamdulillah, it was a great day for us on the occasion of Compassion Day, that is Yom E Rehmat. Compassion Day is celebrated on the 12th Rabiul Awal, that is the third month of the Islamic calendar, to mark the coming of Prophet Muhammad as a divine messenger and as a mercy to all mankind and all living beings. We will try our best to keep up this good work in the future also in a well-organized manner. On the occasion of Christmas, work teams of Bangalore, Gulbarga, Belgaum, and Tumkur distributed hundreds of cards to our Christian brothers and shared in their happiness. Different churches and cathedrals were visited, including Fatima Cathedral Church at Belgaum, and the message of peace, love, harmony, and brotherhood was conveyed to our Christian brethren. On 26 December, the members of work stood along with the farmers of the country and showed support to them. Water and biscuits were distributed among the police and the public. On 3rd January 2020 morning, 12 members from Work Bangalore team visited the Home of Hope, founded by Brother T. Raja, better known as Otto Raja, at Bangalore. The team felicitated him with a memento and a bouquet for his remarkable contribution towards the destitute. It was overwhelming to see him taking care of nearly 700 residents, destitute and homeless, including men, women, and children. Work team donated 125 kg of rice and 100 kg of flour. He was kind enough to take us through his huge premises. We got a chance to meet and communicate with the residents. Later, a small discussion was held with Brother Raja to understand the future requirements for his center. In reviving the attribute of compassion of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, Work Karnataka distributed food and ration kits amongst the poor and visited an orphanage. Food and drinking water was distributed in the premises of various hospitals and other localities. An interfaith dialogue for communal harmony was organized by the Karnataka chapter of work in the form of a webinar on 31st January 2021. We had many esteemed speakers amongst us. Work Karnataka organized a visit to Pavagada, Tumkur, wherein they met Swami Ramamurthy and discussed plans for bringing peace in the society. Work is active on various social media platforms. Anyone wishing to contact us may do so. Thank you all for your patient. Thank you all for your patient hearing. Over to you, Halima.
Thank you, Sister Samina, for a detailed PowerPoint presentation which helped us understand the organization and the various activities that are conducted by Work. Anyone interested in being a part of this organization, please get in touch with us through the number shared. We will now move on to the question and answer session. I hope the speakers are ready. The first question is to Ms. Teresa. How to develop confidence in children? Ma'am, could you please highlight us on that?
How to develop confidence?
Confidence in children.
Yes. You see, first and foremost, as I said, we as parents have to set an example to them. Now, in small things that the child does, begin to appreciate the child. No matter, it may be very insignificant for you, but for a child, it is very important. So appreciate the child. You know what, quite often what we do is, we try to say, oh, you did that, you could have done it this way. No, appreciate the child, guide the child. If ever you feel what the child is doing is wrong, perhaps you can say, how about doing it this way, rather than saying that is not the way. Okay. So appreciating the children, even in the smallest things, is very, very important, because with small steps, we take bigger steps. Okay. So in order to create that confidence in the children, it's very, very important for us parents to appreciate them. You see, you don't blame the teachers. Do not blame the principal. Do not blame the society. It is you, and it is only you who is responsible for that. If you tell your child that you trust her, if you tell the child, yes, what you have done is very good, congratulations. How often do we do that? How often do we do? Your child may get 50 this time, next time when the child gets 55. Have you appreciated the child? Rather, you may say, what is the percentage of the next one who sits next to you? Failing to realize this is your child, and it is your child's performance, not somebody else's child's performance. So, begin to appreciate your child, which is very, very important. The child will definitely gain confidence. I'm speaking through my experience as a mother. I'm speaking through my experience as a grandmother. I'm speaking through my experience as a teacher.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Definitely, we cannot gain confidence just over a night. It is going to take some time. But we need to be positive as adults and instill that in our children. Thank you so much.
Yes.
My next question is for Dr. Girija. What is the right age to discuss intimate health with girl child? Today we all agree that we definitely need to talk to our children, but then we don't know the right age to discuss all of these things. Can Dr. Girija highlight on that?
Definitely. The thing is, like, what going by my experiences, we should also teach to the around any of these tiny tots when you're sending outside to the school, Montessori, be it school of primary schooling and all, you have to discuss them that there is a good touch and a bad touch that is sufficient for their age. That their private parts should be touched only by them and maximum by their mother. Nobody, but not even of her closest brothers or the cousins or the aunts or uncles or any of those workers, you know, the people who come to home or even at school also, they have to know that, because they are at a very, very innocent age group where they don't understand that auto uncle or a person, a teacher who is so sweet also can harm them. They are not in a position to understand that why this is happening. So many a times it has been seen that the people who are very close to their family, very close to them, do such abuses, inflict such abuses. So for their age group, just explain to them what are the private part, and that is the area which should be touching them. And it's not good. If anything, report to the mother, and mother should believe. In India, what I mean, many of places, what happens is we don't believe them. They think that they're creating a story out of it, which is not right. You have to believe your child and definitely ask her more about that. Okay, and then comes the sex education. See, pre-pubertal stage, as a mother, as it's a duty to explain to them why menstruation occurs and why the body changes so, and what mental and physical changes a girl goes through that age. It is the age where the estrogen and progesterone are playing havoc in her body and in her mind. They'll have all sorts of mood swings, all sorts of irritability. They think that why is so happening in her body? Why this changes? So what is the science beyond that? That has to be explained in the 8 to 9 years age group. Because during that age, nowadays we are seeing early puberties. So if you don't explain to the children why the bleeding occurs, it's quite normal. She has not done anything wrong. There is nothing like, see, even in our ancestors who followed all those beliefs, they had a science beyond it. Because you see, when you take it 300, 400 years back scene, that time a lady had to do all the work, right? From grinding. Now we have mixers, grinders, we have a stove and all. That time she has to take care of the cattle, then she has to go to the farm. She had to cater to all the needs of the family, even ground, what we have a mixer and all these things. Now that facility she didn't have that time. So that during menstruation, we are prone to infections. We are prone to tiredness, lethargy and weakness. So they were made to sit in a corner. That is not that later on we followed it as blindly as a taboo, a belief system. We didn't see the science behind it. So that shouldn't be done. So now we have all sorts of things. So we should tell them that this is a physiological thing to happen. So discussing 8 to 9 years of age group, what are the changes going to happen? How they should be ready to accept it. And coming to sexual education, I think around 14 to 15 would be the right age to discuss about these things. They will be very curious. So curiosity leads them to search in wrong places. They will not approach you. They will not approach the mother. They think it's not right. Mommy is not going to discuss. And the mothers also act like very, severe in such aspects, not trying to explain her this is the scene. I think we should not delay it more. That the time they'll gather it from all wrong sources, which will give them wrong information. So 14 to 15, you have to explain what are external organs, what are internal, what is a womb, how the process of baby making is, so that they're not in a dark about it. And who is, and definitely curiosity is raging in these youngsters. These teenagers, they'll ask their friends. The friends are equally innocent, they don't know anything, then they go for, nowadays the mobile and internet, I think, is the worst creation of mankind, which they Google, internet, everything is available on tip of finger, and definitely your wrong information is plenty, and then they get the wrong information. And not only sex education is important in the 14 to 15 year age group, to prevent these unwanted pregnancies which are on rise these days, and also sexually transmitted diseases. They don't know what harm that is going to cause to their body. Everything is very instant nowadays, and they look for very instant solutions. So mothers can definitely tell the children in 14 to 15 age groups. So these are the various age groups where you can teach your child.
Thank you so much, ma'am. My next question is to Ms. Rajeshwari. There are two questions that I would like to ask her. One is depression manageable or curable? Another one is, how can we know a person is suffering from depression and how can we help?
Yeah. Hello?
Yes, ma'am. I'm able to hear you.
Yeah, I just had a little technical glitch.
Okay.
Yeah, can you
do you want me to repeat the question?
That will help me, please.
There are two questions. One is depression manageable or curable? Can it be cured, throughout, completely, thoroughly? Is that's one question. And the second one is, how can we know a person is going through depression or suffering from depression? And how do we help that person overcome?
Yes. So the first thing is depression curable? It is yes, and it can also be no. We don't know because we don't know the kind of the type of depression and the depth of depression, and it is to do with the mental state, right? It is a very, very relative question. That's what I would want to say. But then many of the disorders, if it has got into a chronic disorder, it has to be managed. But definitely, if it is detected, if it is, if a person becomes aware of the depression at a very, very early stage, say whatever I told you, 3 months, 6 months and things like that, the person can manage himself. It is like this. Many a times it can be cured. Many a times it has to be managed. Take, for example, if we have a myopic eye, we put a glass and we maintain, is it not? So there could be situations like that. So here I cannot say it is completely curable. I cannot say it cannot be cured also, but the interventions are there and it can definitely be managed. In many instances, it can also be cured. That's what I would want to talk about. The other thing is, how do we identify the depression? Some of the symptoms, whatever I have told you, the feeling of loneliness, feeling of sadness, constantly crying, and the bloated feeling, nauseatic kind of a feeling, and stomach churning, and wanting to be isolating somewhere, and very, very very, very low self-worth, and suicidal tendencies, and things like that. There are so many kind of symptoms, but any one symptom does not qualify for depression. It has to be a spectrum of the symptoms. There has to be a lot of symptoms also to be evaluated. Many a times we think that we are going through depression, but when I actually go to a psychiatrist, many a times it could just be an anxiety. So it is better to first of all take care of the primary health. You will have to probably, as Dr. Girija is mentioning, definitely seek the doctor's help, go through the vitals and understand what's happening. If it is treatable at that stage, it's fine. But if it continues, definitely you'll have to seek the psychiatrist help. For every small anxiety, we don't have to run to a psychiatrist, but at least you should discuss with your own physicians or with your own family health doctors as to what is happening. And from there, either you can seek this, psychotherapist's help. Many a times it's not needed that you will have to go to a psychiatrist. Probably the counseling help or the psychotherapist help can also be helpful. But I feel the family health care person, whoever is your doctor, they will be the best people to go and discuss this problem and then identify. That's what, and it's better not to kind of take self decisions on this, situation. So have I answered all the three?
Yes, I think that's what, we shouldn't be judgmental about people if they're just showing small and simple symptoms. We should wait and see for them throughout and then maybe seek help from a professional.
Yes. So being vocal about what we are going is very important. Speaking about what we are going through is very important. And in just in case, you know, there are also kind of counselors, you know, who you can seek an appointment and even speak to a counselor. Okay, this is what is happening. Probably based on the kind of symptoms, even they will also be able to. I'm talking about the psychological counselors, yes, or the clinical psychologists. You can also seek an appointment and speak to them and tell them these are the things what you're going through, and they will be in a position to assess the situation. Okay, definitely the person might need either the family health. Many a times we don't know, probably a small correction of an electrolyte can also, you know, kind of put the person back into action. We don't know, but it has to be a gradual step-by-step process, and definitely help has to be sought. It cannot be ignored. Earlier you seek help, it is better, right? Yeah. It is like that, a deep scar. Many a times the scars might remain, right? But the wound is healed. Those kind of situations will also be there. But see, remember, mental health, you know, I don't think anyone has said that there is a permanent cure. You know, I think Dr. Girija also agrees with me, if I'm not wrong, right? We cannot say that permanently there's something going to be cured. But many a times, even I've heard chronic illnesses like schizophrenia, the person is aware of how to manage, you know, they have learned to manage their, their mood swings and things like that. So it is better to seek help at the right time and then proceed living a harmonious life.
Thank you so much, Ms. Rajeshwari. And of course, as human beings, we need to be empathetic towards the people around us when they are there, you know, be there at least to listen to them and then, you know, get to the professional. Thank you so much.
Absolutely right. Yes.
The next question is for Ms. Nazia. There are two questions which look almost similar to me. I will read this out to you. The question is, you rightly highlighted the need of logical faith. How can we educate to others to not have the blind faith? And another question which was followed was, we know that the religion has given equal rights to women, but the society is so unfair to women. How can we get rid of this? Sister Nazia, your question is, you have rightly highlighted the need of logical faith. How can we educate to others not to have blind faith?
Yeah. How do we need to help others find out, like, logical, how to use logic in what was your question?
You have rightly highlighted the need of logical faith. How can we educate to others not to have blind faith? What are the ways that you can educate people outside to not have these kind of blind faith? Of course, we all see, and most of us have overcome, you know, in today's world. But we still see, like, you know, there are so many places where people are into the blind faith. So how do we overcome, and what are some of the ways that you can share with us, ma'am?
The first thing we can do is, we are, as a representative, we should stop doing it. Like dowry, which is silently still prevailing in our society. We choose to give thinking that it's okay, it's a part of our culture, or it's okay, we are giving it for our girl child as a gift. The minute we stop giving it, one by one, slowly there, the change begins from yourself. First, we can change ourselves, and then we can stop the close and near and dear ones who are close to us from stopping these things, like educating them. Education is the very important thing, like education in schools. Schools also can introduce students to these topics. And most importantly, mothers. Mothers, as I said, are the first teachers. They are the ones who form the main characters in the kids. So it is important for the mothers to train their kids, especially how I'm clubbing both the questions as well, like how not to differentiate between a girl child and a boy child. So what mothers can do is, when a mother kisses a girl child, she simultaneously kisses a boy child also, so that they too feel a sense of equality at home itself. When at home they are seeing that the equal treatment is being given to a girl as well as boy, they carry this perspective along when they move into the society. So home is the learning place. It is the most important for all of us as women to give right education to the kids so that kids know like what they need to carry on to the society, the values that they need to move on with in the society. Like they need to be taught like your sister needs to be treated equally like you are being treated. The same amount of love, the same amount of material things, gifts, everything need to be balanced. So that he do not differ, the boy does not think like, no, I am superior. My mother is loving me more. I am getting more gifts. I am being loved more. So that if we balance between the kids, then the kids also will learn to balance. Like, you know, if we give respect to a girl, a daughter, a mother, we need to teach a child also. Like you need to give respect to the daughter, to your sister, to your mother, or any other woman in the society. And equality, right? Equality. Yeah. I hope I have answered the question.
Yes, Ms. Nadia, thank you. Another question to Ms. Teresa. We see a lot of anger in today's children. How do we overcome that anger?
We see a lot of anger. Now, why is that anger syndrome? It may be either because while they were small children, little children, you yielded to their tantrums. And they have learned, when I play some tantrums, my parents will listen to me. So this tantrum syndrome has developed into anger syndromes, actually. All right. Second reason, perhaps, I do not know under what circumstances a person wanted to know this. Second thing, maybe you are not accepted the child when he wanted you to accept what he or she did. Okay, certain times, if it is a girl child in the family, we know if there are boys and girls, we know how the girl child is given a lower, most often, sadly, a girl child is given a lower position. She may not be allowed to do this, do that, while the boys are allowed. And the children get into tantrums, anger. Why? Why am I not allowed? Why is that one? So as I said earlier, when you explain to a child why he or she should not do that, give a reason. Children want to know why. If you have answered the question, why this had happened, perhaps if it was such a situation. Now, if I am told under what circumstances they get angry, perhaps we may be able to throw a little light on that. But anyway, so it may be the anger, tantrum that they played in their childhood was appreciated. Rather, we gave in to them very easily because they're crying. Okay, let me give in. That's it has developed into anger. Sometimes the rejection, either by the family, rejection by the siblings, rejection by the peer group. In teenagers, normally this anger tantrum is when they feel that their peers are better than them. Our family is not up to their standard. They begin to compare. Yes, the children begin to compare and they feel somebody else's parents are doing better than my parents or giving them more things than my parents. Okay, now, if I not explain to my child from the child, see, these are the rules and regulations of the family. That's what I told you. We should have certain set rules. We should have certain kind of those ethics that we have to teach our children. Have I taught my children those ethical values from the childhood? I don't think my child will begin to compare. And even if he begins to compare, you have an explanation. See, I can afford only this much. I cannot afford beyond this. This is our situation. Okay. And I give it. I think initially, the child will take a bit time, but that it may be because of the peer pressure quite often. Nowadays, teenagers' angers are normally because of the peer pressure. My friends have this, I don't have that. They begin to compare themselves with that. So when they're not able to get it, they get frustrated. They get angry with their parents. And I'm afraid to say this, but sometimes they may say, why are you my parents? If you could not afford to give me this, why did you have me? Children do say this. Yes, and that is very, very hurting for the parents. So, but I don't think it is normal. It should not happen. The children should not go to that extent. But at the same time, we as parents, I think, should have a little bit of patience, wait for the child's anger to subside, sit with the child, explain to the child. When their anger subsides, I feel, because I've tried it with my students when they have, maybe because they're outsider students, it might be that true, but I worked out with my students where I was, and the parents would tell me without their knowledge, ma'am, this, she's doing this, she's doing this, she's doing that. And, you know, creating some situations or telling them as if it's a story, not letting out that the parents have confided in me, I've been able to change this attitude of the children, to make them realize that their parents care for them. It is their parents ultimately who love them, who will be with them till the end of their life, and not their friends. Or, you know, I was able to do that. So initially, as I said, from their very childhood, if we put in these values, things become a bit easier. I don't say that they don't get angry. I don't say that they don't give in to all this kind of thing. It's just natural, but we may be able to help them out. Yes. Do not react. Do not react when they, you respond. See, reaction and response is two different things. Don't react. When they get angry, if we also react, we are at a loss. Okay, because the child will say no, and they're stronger. They'll destroy things and things like that. But when you respond positively, sympathetically, and, you know, with kindness and gentleness, keep quiet at that moment when they throw tantrum, because you know it's impossible to talk to them. It's impossible to explain to them at that moment. Okay. So you be composed, you keep your mental control, and when they come, they cool down, speak to them. I think that will work. At least it works 75 to 90%.
Hopefully, okay. Yeah.
Be a friend to your child rather than a dictator. This is very important. Be a friend, ask him, talk to him, talk to her, and, you know, your child should learn to confide, and I think it should be positive. You know, that's what I told you. From the very beginning, if you bring them up, I think we have conquered many of our problems.
Thank you. And I think that, like, you know, if we are thrown anger, if our adults throw anger at us, we also learn to throw anger at someone. And same happens with all the activities of our life. As children, they try to imitate what yes. the adults do.
Yes.
So exactly. If we are calm and composed, children will also learn to be calm. And they should also learn, like, you know, anger is an emotion. It's a feeling. So yes. they just need to know to manage it. Yes. It's not that's, wrong to feel angry. It's the way that we react is, it makes that is what, it bad, you know.
That's why I said, don't react. True. Don't react. Respond positively.
Okay. Thank you, Mrs. Teresa. I have another question for Dr. Girija. Women feel shy in expressing health problems. What is the responsibility of a husband regarding this?
Oh, yeah. Actually, what's the responsibility of husband regarding this? Yeah. See, as Sister Teresa told just now, that a boy, and even Sister Nazia told, that a boy and a girl should be brought up in a healthy environment by the mother. So there should be not differentiation at home. So it should begin at home. So the boy should be known to respect the girl, his sister, or anybody. He should not be always brought up in a limelight that he's the heir to the house, so he can do and he can get over with whatever he has done wrong also, and sister gets punished. So the boy should be instilled from the young age itself that a woman has to be respected. So then only they'll go into an adult where they'll, as a male, they'll respect their wives. So what habits and values are inculcated in the childhood that carries on into their adulthood also. Otherwise, they just see the wife as a piece of for love or lust, and she's meant to do all the work. As in young age only in the childhood, they should be made to do equal amount of work as a girl child. Doesn't mean that the boy should not know what the kitchen work is and what the other responsibilities also they should shoulder. So then they will definitely even help their wives in the day-to-day daily chores and in the kitchen work, be it the children and all. So as a husband, when a wife is newly married, they should give a lot of importance so that to the wife also, to see to that she gets adjusted to the new household. Definitely a new beginning for her also. He should see to balance between his family members and the wife. And when she gets pregnant, pregnancy is another thing. Totally, when a lot of changes happen in her body and even in her mental status. So he should be very supportive. In Western countries and all, the husbands do attend the yoga, this exercise sessions, which are antenatal exercises, which are scheduled for the lady. The pregnant woman not only goes goes alone. When she doesn't go alone, she takes her husband also. Even they know what is the pain or the her his wife is going through. So what are different stages of pregnancy? Be it vomiting or loss of appetite and then more of appetite. So he should get involved in each and every activity of his wife during her pregnancy, during the childbirth, and also after the childbirth, he should also share the duties of taking care of the child, because women after giving birth they feel a lot of difficulties. They'll change, they'll be lactating, they'll be feeding the child, they'll feel more hungry, their body shape is totally in chaos, and they feel that everybody, she's not beautiful like what she was before. Suddenly the husband is not looking at her at all. So that shouldn't happen. He should say that this is just a passing phase. They should be even trained in the nappy changing to taking care of the child as equally as this. And nowadays women are working. Many of the women are working. So they should be ready to share and support her in all aspects of her life. And even in midlife and the menopausal age, they should realize that a woman, they have during their menstrual cycle, premenstrual phase, there is a dysmenorrhea pain, that thing and all. They should be more of compassionate love, affection and empathy. They should show and share her work and take her to doctor and be personally involved in all her health checkups also. That matters a lot and lot, not just gifts and saris and diamonds and all. It's a different thing, but mostly you have to show a lot of love and respect.
Thank you so much. And I think that responsibility falls back on a woman, you know, because we are going to raise those men.
Yeah, isn't it? Mother plays
so,
a very,
very important,
a very important role.
You teach your child to value. And when he grows big, he will value his wife and take care of
correct. Her. It begins at home, and the first teacher is definitely the mother. She can definitely teach her son to become a better husband.
Thank you so much, Dr. Girija. One last question, I think, to Ms. Nazia. Do women need to always say yes to wrong demand of the society? Because there's a lot of social pressure that we all go through. So should a woman say yes to everything that is imposed on us? And if you say no, then how do we say it?
See, I think I have covered this in my topic where I said that, you know, women should be very firm in saying no when it does not cater to her needs. See, being good does not mean that she takes everything that is thrown at her, right? We can be good. I can be a good human being by saying no to certain things which I feel are being done unjustly to me. So this is the attitude we need to teach girls. When, you know, they learn to say no to certain things like dowry pressure or being unjust or husband molesting the wives, all these things are not the things that women need to take. They need to be firm against it. They need to say a plain no. And if they do not find answers there, they have other places to find help for. You have psychiatrists, you have your parents. First of all, you need to find solace in your family. If your family is there to protect you, you can always go back. If not, then you have other places, you have helplines, you have online counselors, all these things. So women need not take all that is being thrown at us. Like, yeah, but certainly it does not mean that we say no to everything. We need to maintain a balance in every order of, in everything, no, every aspect of life. We need to maintain a balance. There is a slight difference between right and wrong. If we maintain a balance, we will not go wrong. We need to maintain a balance. Then we should be very sure whether it is right or whether it is wrong. Once we know it is wrong, then we need not take it. Yeah. But if it is right, then maybe even though if it is a little difficult for you, maybe you can think over it, or maybe we can make a slight change in our behavior. I hope it has answered the question. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Nazia. I know definitely, you know, balancing our lives is very important. Sometimes we take extremes in our lives. When we have to say no, we always say no. And when we have to say yes, we just, you know, leave everything and say yes to it. And striking the balance is very important. Thank you so much. We are at the end of our session now. I would like to convey my heartfelt thanks to all the speakers who gave their valuable time and shared knowledge with us. A big thank you to the audience for attending this webinar and making it fruitful. I would also like to thank the organizers for conducting such an amazing event on Women's Day. Do share your feedback in the comment section of Facebook page. I hope all of you will continue to support us throughout our journey. Happy Women's Day. And thank you to all of you.
Happy Women's Day to everyone.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Wish you all the same.
Thank you.